drunk when I had a port, really, but never mind.
You flatter me, Captain Salon. But legend implies the past tense, whereas I am very much focused on our present circumstances.
I didn't mean to suggest you were stuck in the past. You're right, Ambassador. Most diplomatic choice of words.
You are a legend, Ambassador. There's not an officer in Starfleet that doesn't know of your career.
I would never assume that to be the case.
We were hoping you could fill us in on the details. We got the basics from Starfleet. Two formerly peaceful neighbors are now on the brink of war.
Indeed. And the tension between them grows fiercer by the hour. Olivia and Hotari. The Olivians are the more advanced species. They made first contact with the Hotari over a century ago. This is Tai, the Hotari moon. It is rich in dilithium, and for decades, the Hotari and the Olivians have shared a mining operation there. The Olivians provide the technological resources, and the Hotari have served as the labor force. The stability of that arrangement was the source of their peace, until recently. The Hotari have suddenly and forcefully seized control of the mining operations and expelled the Olydians from their system. That is the official story, as told by the Hotari when they requested Federation mediation. But the details remain kept. Communications between all parties have been limited by the ionic interference.
Have the Olydians retaliated against the Hotari? Or taken any action against them?
Surprisingly, they have not yet responded in kind. They were open to a Federation presence, but it is unlikely the relatively primitive Hotari forces would stand a chance against the Olydian fleet in open war. Left unchecked, this conflict will result in more bloodshed, which is what we are here to prevent.
And the dilithium trade hangs in the balance.
Clearly, the Hotari have been exploited in this relationship.
Maybe we can persuade them peace is the more profitable alternative for everyone. They both profited from the mines. And for the Hotari, something is better than nothing. Peace is our objective after all.
That is correct.
The Hotari just won their independence. It's hard to believe they would give that up just for profit.
I agree. It would be exceedingly difficult to bring the Hotari to that position.
Neither the Olydians or the Hotari are members of the Federation, so we can't make them do anything.
There is an additional complicating factor I should mention. In the past, the Federation has relied on the Olydians as a source of dilithium.
That certainly changes things.
Federation sources its dilithium from a lot of places.
Yeah, and this is one of them.
We could use that as leverage with the Olydians. They'll want the Federation to continue buying from them.
There might be something to that, Commander.
Putting that on the table could make the Hotari more hostile.
Given the Federation's involvement in the Olydian dilithium trade, Captain Salam and I must make every effort to appear neutral in these negotiations.
What worries me is if this whole thing unravels and we're at the mercy of the storm at less than full strength.
We can't let it come to that.
Considering what the Ion Storm has done to our ship and the Ambassador's shuttle, we have to assume the Olydian fleet has had problems with it as well. This recent surge in the energy disturbance temporarily levels the playing field.
Commander Westbrook is correct. The energy anomalies around the Hotari systems have been noted in the past. But they have never been observed on the orders of magnitude we have seen in recent weeks.
If it's keeping the two sides talking instead of shooting at each other, that actually helps us negotiate a peace.
And we'll take advantage of that as long as it works in our favor.
And when it doesn't?
All the more reason to learn as much about it as we can while we are here. We do not want to be caught unprepared should the energy anomaly continue to fluctuate. I trust we understand our circumstances.
We're operating on a strict timetable here. We're going to be leaving for the negotiations shortly. Commander Westbrook, I want you to leverage our systems to investigate the anomaly from here while we're gone.
Aye, Captain.
Thank you all.
Dismissed.
I want to speak to both of you privately.
Ambassador Spock, I'd like to make a formal introduction. My first officer, Commander Jara Ryder.
Commander, as you are aware, there are limits to what Captain Solano and I can do in our official capacity as representatives of the Federation.
But someone in an unofficial capacity,
your first officer, Commander Ryder could ingratiate himself to certain parties behind the scenes, where they may be more candid in revealing information that could lead to a resolution.
She certainly goes her own way. Maybe that helps in this case. It would be unconventional.
I'm honored to be included in the negotiation process.
You're not just included, you're instrumental.
Well, I hope Commander Rydek will have more luck finding out what really happened than we will through official diplomatic channels.
The fate of the negotiations, the interests of the Federation, and the prospect for peace very well depend on it.
Mr. Diaz, I understand you have already discussed the warp drive failure with Ambassador Spock.
I have.
It is imperative that the Ambassador's shuttle be flight ready. I need you both to ascertain the root cause of the system failures he encountered.
I'm surprised, Commander. I thought you would have wanted to work on Ambassador Spock's shuttle yourself.
I respect the Ambassador and his many accomplishments, but I do not derive any satisfaction from interacting with his shuttle as if it were somehow transubstantiated through its association with him. Especially when I have the entirety of this starship to concern myself with. I am not the chief engineer of this shuttle.
The Ambassador asked me to take a look, and I'm ready to crack this thing open.
Good. You could learn from Mr. Diaz's focus.
I'll take notes.
Then I will leave you to it. Make note of any abnormalities in your report. Carry on.
It seems like he's warming up to us.
Yeah.
Even Chobok has to look at that face and know you've earned some real respect. And I have to admit that I owe you one. You were right to make me go first. I don't know what I was thinking. You did the smart thing.
You've pulled me out of trouble how many times? Call it even.
Okay. At the very least, maybe I can track down that bottle of Saurian brandy you're still on the hook for. But first, we have work to do.
Ready to go?
All set. Let's run the diagnostic.
Meow. Wax on. Bunny ears.
So, I know about your talk with Miranda.
You do?
She sent me a Priority One dispatch right after your conversation. I'm happy for you. Both of you.
Thanks.
But I'm only going to tell you this once. Don't screw this up. Because I would be very unhappy if you tried this out and then, I don't know, 6 weeks or 6 days later, I have to start splitting holidays between the two of you. All because things went south and you're not on speaking terms. That just isn't gonna work for me. And I know you'll respect that.
Are you upset?
Not in your life, Diaz. But you need to be careful. like my friends and I like our group. I don't want to lose that. Is that thing done yet?
Yeah, it's wrapping up. Let's see. The relays along the primary EPS are blown. The backup relays are all intact.
An EPS overload from the warp drive could cause that. But how did the shuttle end up dead in the water?
Maybe the ship's data recorder can tell us something.
What's up with that? That it'll be really quiet and all of a sudden, just out of nowhere, just get a lot louder when they're talking.
Here.
They were only about 8 minutes from their plotted warp point. No faults, just those warnings. What are they?
Not like the flashy beeps on your own bridge earlier.
Field became inverted suddenly.
I've seen this happen when the center warp coil cracks.
A cracked warp coil throws a fault code.
Still, we should take a look.
Subspace variance out of tolerance. What does that mean?
It means the main navigation array lost sight of space somehow.
Will the array going offline cause that?
Yes, but it should have also thrown a fault code.
Was a complete warp cascade failure.
Wow. They're lucky the shuttle didn't turn inside out.
Makes me think the computer panicked on the warp field equation.
Any one of these failures should have thrown a fault.
If it was caused by a system failure.
None of this caused the relays to blow. Roll forward to when that happened.
Yes, ma'am.
So here, they take a moment to get their bearings, and they attempt to re-engage the warp drive.
There. That's the relays blowing.
And look, there's another warp system alert.
And they're all the same. Subspace variants out of tolerance, warp inversions. Finally, there's a complete warp cascade failure.
Then it's one of two things. Either a warp coil is cracked, or the navigation array is offline.
That makes sense.
Divide and conquer. You want to check the warp coils or the navigation array? I'll check the other. Let's not overcomplicate this. One of these systems is likely broken.
I'll check the nacelles for a cracked coil. Checked every coil on the port nacelle for imbalances. If any coil in either engine were cracked, I would have detected it. So, it must be the navigation array.
Except it's not. Checked and double-checked.
Well, the readings don't lie.
Here comes the security detail for the way team.
Uh-oh. She's basically a red shirt.
Hey.
I'm not here.
We're escorting the negotiating team to the surface as soon as they come down from the bridge. I don't want to interrupt some important work. I was just hoping to see you before I go. The captain and the others will be here in a minute now. Should be an interesting ride down to the surface.
Come on, I'm never too busy to make time for you.
That's not true.
No, but I am glad you came by.
No, that's more accurate.
I gotta be precise with you, huh?
Hey, Maris. Aren't these those button pushers you're always hanging out with?
And you're the phaser jockeys we always meet in Parisi Squares, right?
All aboard for Hotari!
That another one of the captain's railroad things?
Gotta be. I just usually zone out by the time he gets to the hole. Steam engines were the warp drives of their day part. Catch y'all later.
You don't want to miss your train.
I do have to go. Not gonna lie, I'd rather not leave right now. More important things on my mind.
Do me a favor. Back safe.
Deal. If you see any.
Lower decks dalliance. Okay.
Eduardo Diaz. If you could float back down to reality, we still have a ways to go. All right, where were we?
So, the warp coils in the navigation array are fine, but the computer doesn't seem to think so.
I'm out of ideas short of field stripping the shuttle from bow to stern.
You wanna take this out of the shuttle and throw it on the bench?
Oh, real hands-on maintenance. I like it. Okay, the nav computer is patched into the ship.
The ship's computer can double-check our work. If the shuttle's nav computer is putting out false data, we'll know it.
Let's run through the shuttle's logs again.
Running now. Same. Warp field inversion and the cascade failure. However, the Resolute computer doesn't show the same subspace variance.
We're in the same conditions that the shuttle was in when it failed. Why wouldn't the ship's computer get a matching result?
What if the subspace variance was a momentary occurrence?
That's a possibility, and it would explain why the simulation under our current sensor readings failed to reproduce the issue.
But a subspace anomaly strong enough to cause a warp field collapse would leave graviton ripples for days.
Let's run with the momentary subspace variance theory for now. Roll forward to the shuttle's attempt to re-engage the warp drive. We need the conditions of space around the shuttle at the moment of warp failure.
Resuming simulation.
Error in warp field calculation. Cochrane formula variables are out of range.
That right there. Take the shuttle sensor data from that moment.
Computer, why did the warp field calculation fail?
Warp field pressure returned non-orthogonal. Results are undefined.
That doesn't help.
Wait, what if we use a different ship?
Put the Resolute into the simulation instead of the shuttle.
Yeah, it should work just fine. Unless... Computer, run the simulation with the Resolute.
Resolute simulated.
Computer, give me manual control on the warp power. Just happened to us. The Resolute will not sustain.
can't leave Hotari space.